You know about inline engines, V engines, you maybe even have heard of a VR engine layout. But what do you know about W, H, or U engines? Since cars have been on the road getting our human butts from divorced dad's house to stepmom's house, engineers have been putting all sorts of wild engine configurations in them. And today, we are gonna go through every single one. Let's go.
Thanks to Keats for sponsoring today's video. Any moment now, the love of my life is gonna walk through those doors. Her name is Jerry with a G. I know, talk about exotic, huh? We dated years ago, but Dave scared her away. So I locked him in the basement, hoping she'd come back. She never did. And then I found her on this new dating app just for bird friends. Jerry? Jerry, you look beautiful.
You look different.
Ever since you left, I became one of the 2 out of 3 guys to experience some sort of male pattern baldness by the time they were 35.
Oh, my sweet, sweet Jerry. You should've used Keeps.
You know about Keeps?
Who doesn't, Jerry? They help prevent hair loss by connecting you to a doctor online for your hair loss consultation. And they'll even ship your hair loss medication directly to your door every 3 months.
That's what I've been telling them. I always say, when you're ready to take action, go to keeps.com/B2B or click the link in the description below and you get 50% off your first order.
All this talk of Keeps makes me realize how much I miss you.
Wow. Brains and beauty.
Dave, what are you doing here? Get out of here, Dave.
David, get. David, I'm using your full name, so that means I'm really mad at you.
I hate birds.
No, Jerry, stay.
Dave, get out of here, Jerry. No, Jerry, no!
Now, the first rule when watching any type of YouTube list video is that, one, there are no rules. Okay, now that we've established that, we're gonna go through every engine configuration that I could find that's been put in a car. Now, if I happen to miss any by the end of this video, just go ahead and write them down. You can mail them to me. We have a PO box. I'm gonna take all of them and then I'm gonna put them in the trash. Okay, so let's start off with inline engines. All the cylinders are in a straight line, hence their name. And the straight cylinder design seems pretty intuitive if you were to start from scratch and building your own engine, but it's also a very mechanically smart design. With only one cylinder head, there are fewer moving parts than engines with multiple cylinder heads. So you have less stuff means less chance for other stuff failing. This allows for a less mechanically complex layout. They're simple engines. And because they are simple, they're cheaper, and for the most part, they're easier to maintain. So let's start off with the least number of cylinders in this inline configuration. And in all honesty, I was gonna start with an inline 2, but there are some cars out there with single cylinder inline engines. One cylinder, one piston, one connecting rod, one crank, one balancer, 2 valves, the 1903 Oldsmobile Curved Dash, which is documented actually as being the first mass produced car. Well known fact. From there, we can go to our inline 2 or straight twin. The Fiat 500 sported this 2-cylinder setup. Of course, of all the inline engines, the coolest is the Koenigsegg twin turbo inline 3. Inline 4s, we have every engine and the majority of cars on the road. My first car, 1990 Toyota pickup, had a 22RE. You guys know the story. My sister freaking stole it from me and then sold it. So if you have it, I want it back. There's the Mitsubishi 4G63T, the S14 V25, and BMW's E30 M3. Honda, they got the F20C S2000. Now they're small, so you can put them anywhere. They're front engine, mid engine, rear engine. The Ford Banger is a worldwide staple. The only downside to an inline 4 is that it needs a counterbalancer. The secondary forces aren't balanced, which ultimately limits the size of the engine, and because of that, they often need balancing shafts to cancel out those vibrations. Okay, that's inline 4. So now let's get to inline 5s. But why would you want that? Well, they're smoother than an inline 4 and smaller than an inline 6. To help me explain why the 5-cylinder is smoother, we need to look at the timing of the power strokes. Now, 4-stroke engines operate in 4 cycles, suck, squeeze, bang, blow. Every cylinder fires once every 720 degrees, 2 rotations of the crank. If we divide 720 degrees by the number of cylinders, we get how often a power stroke occurs. Your power stroke can't last longer than 180 degrees of crankshaft rotation. So a 3-cylinder engine, there's a gap in the power delivery. So if you take 720 degrees, divided by 3, minus 180, there's 60 degrees of silence when no power strokes take place. So for a four cylinder, take 720 divided by four, that's 180. You subtract 180, you get zero. So at the end of one cylinder's power stroke, another cylinder fires. Now with a five cylinder, there's a 36 degree overlap, meaning another power stroke has occurred before the crankshaft rotates to the 180 degree mark. This results in a very smooth power delivery, instead of this kind of relatively jolting action of an inline four. And you can use this equation for any type of cylinder configuration to see when they're firing. So who uses inline fives? Well, my favorite is the Swedish American built 2.5 liter in the Focus RS 500. Also GM, they have a 3.7 liter in the Hummer H3, and the RS 2 Avant got one, but we never got it in the US, so whatever. Next, we have the Sexy Sixes, the perfectly balanced Sexy Sixer. Now, there's so many great examples of this engine. Our favorites are the RB26 and the 2JZ, of course, but they're, like I said, there's a ton of them out there. They're long and strong and the smoothest engine out there. They're just a better inline four. From there, we go into inline eights, the Hungry Eights, the Straight Eights, and they were the performance engine of choice in the late 20s. Bugatti, Duesenberg, Alfa Romeo, Mercedes-Benz, they all had a version of the Straight Eight. The Alfa Romeo 159 Alfreda, it won 47 of 54 Grand Prix in F1 between 1938 and 1951. That little 1.5 liter supercharged inline eight could get all the way up to 10,500 RPM. That's screaming. Skip over the inline 10s because there are none. We go straight to inline 12s. Now there are a few that were ever built in the early 20s and with good reason. When you have a freaking crankshaft that's super long, and you have all the pistons kind of rocking it, creates this jump rope effect. So you gotta have a crank that is super, super stiff, really, really strong. That being said, there were some made, so they're on the list, but there are not a lot of them out there. The V-type engines split the cylinders into two even banks with a common crankshaft at the bottom of the V. Now they're best bros with the inline engines. For the most part, as the cylinder number increases, V engines are more compact compared to their inline bros. And they also have a shorter length than an inline engine with the same number of cylinders, but they're wider. Inline engines, long and skinny. V engines, short and wide. If Nolan was an engine, he'd be a V. If I would be an engine, I'd be an inline. If James were an engine, a boxer. Good job. Twin cylinder Vs, the V twins. So obviously there are a ton of Harleys, the Hogs, they have V twins, but there's actually some in street bikes. I am obsessed with twin cylinder sport bikes. I have an Aprilia Mille, a Honda RC51. I've owned a Suzuki TLR, Ducati 1199. I want one of those. Volkswagen actually took a Ducati twin engine and stuffed it in their XL Sport. Mazda's first car, the R360 rear engine K car, was powered by a V twin engine. We go to V3s. There are no cars that I could find with a V3, but they are in some motorcycles. The V3 engine's got two cylinders on one bank and one cylinder on the other. It's a pretty rare configuration, but they did have some MotoGP bikes that sported this setup. Most famously, Honda's NS500. Next, we go to V4, a MotoGP staple. But while they're the go-to motor in MotoGP, there's not a ton in cars. The Porsche 919 Hybrid LMP1 car used a 2-liter turbo V4 from 2014 to 2017. V5, no cars, but again, got some in motorcycles, the Honda RC211V. V6, the most beloved here at the donut shop. We've blown up two Nissan VQ units, right? Two? I have an EcoBoost that's V6. You probably have one in your NSX. You own an NSX, right? Yeah, cool. V8, the classic. Hemi LS1, Ferrari F106, the Toyota 1UZ FE. They can be a flathead, overhead valve. They can be a pushrod with a crossplane or flat plane crank. The most iconic engine out there with boys who like to brag. Unless you have a V10, like in the Viper, or unless you have a V12, like in an Aston Martin. Now the V12 is a neat engine because each bank operates like a straight six. Remember, the straight six is already a well-balanced engine. So if you use correct V angle between the two banks, a V12 engine can achieve perfect balance. Now what wouldn't be balanced would be a V14, which there are no instances of them being in cars, but we do have V16 engines. Cadillac made a V16 in the 30s. There's also a V18 in the Bell AZ75600 hauler truck. It's one of those big ass mining trucks. There's a V20 in the Caterpillar 797 dump truck and a V24 and a custom built 359 Peterbilt. It makes 3,424 horsepower and is insane. probably heard of VR engines before. The VR6 badges are on the back of Golfs, Passats, Jettas, and they're all in the Volkswagen lineup. Now, VR engines are the results of taking the best of both worlds from the inline and V engine layout. The word R in VR comes from the German word inline, which is Reihenmotor. That'd be good. You get all the benefits of a V engine in terms of performance, but package it in a way which would allow them to fit into compact cars without having to compromise on their size and weight. Also, you need only a single cylinder head for both banks of cylinders, which means only two camshafts are needed. The most common is the VR6, but there are also a few other versions of the V Reihenmotor. Starting with the not very well-known VR4. This engine was used in the Lancia Lambda. Now, it had a 20-degree narrow-angle single-head VR layout. Volkswagen built a 2.3-liter VR5 engine from 97 to 2006. Just take a VR6 and take one of the cylinders off. Why would you want that? Well, when a VR6 is too big. So is there anything bigger than a VR6? Maybe a VR8? Well, there's no single VR8, but there is an engine out there that smashes two VR8s together to make a double V or W configuration. The W engine uses three or four cylinder banks running off the same crankshaft, and it makes that W shape. Starting with the smallest, we have the W3. You can actually buy a 150 cubic inch fueling W3 engine for your motorcycle for a cool $100,000. We have the W6 that was in the Rumpler Tropenwagen. If you put two VR4s together, you have a W8. The sole W8 engine to reach production was the Volkswagen Group W8 engine, which was in the Passat. You slam two VR6 together and you get the W12. We actually did a whole entire episode on B2B about this engine. Click here if you want to watch and learn more. Put two VR8s together and you get a W16. The first car that comes to mind in the 16-cylinder configuration is, of course, the Bugatti Veyron. But the earliest prototypes incorporated an 18-cylinder engine, the W18. There are two ways you can make a W. You can have two banks of two, or you can have three banks of one. The W18 is three sets of six cylinders, but there is a flaw in this design. With a standard V layout, you got your cool intake air on one side, you got your hot exhaust on the other. But with a three-bank W engine, you can't do this. The way the geometry works out means that you're gonna have exhaust next to your intake air. Hot exhaust doesn't mix with cold intake air. So by the time the Veyron reached production, it had ditched a couple of cylinders, added four turbochargers, and got their W16, which was a pretty smart idea. Boxer engine. Sometimes called the horizontally opposed or flat engine. Subi boys and girls, you guys are having fun right now. You're like, yeah, that's my engine. Yeah, woo. Now, they have a central crankshaft with two banks of cylinders, but unlike these, boxer engines have cylinders laid out horizontally with the pistons moving left and right rather than up and down. Now, that horizontal arrangement gives them a low center of gravity, which helps getting power to the wheels and improves handling of whatever car this engine is in. Power delivery? Ooh, it's super smooth throughout, and the engines are easier to cool because of this spread out design. Now, for a long time, these engines were air cooled, but there are some negatives. Boxer engines, they're large, okay? And because they're big and spread out, it's a pain to do some simple jobs. Now, I'm not saying it's harder to work on them than any other cramped V engine or inline engine. I'm not saying that, so don't yell at me, okay? The cylinder heads, they can be pushed up against the sidewalls of the car. Stuff like changing spark plugs is pretty hard to do. They're also a little bit more expensive to manufacture. Don't hate me, Boxer fans. I'm just giving you the facts. Jerry facts. So of the Boxer engines, we have a flat twin. The French company Panhard used a flat twin to win the 24 hours of Le Mans. There's the flat four, which the OG Beetle sported, and the beloved or hated Subi EJ. There's a flat six in the Porsche 911, a flat eight in the Porsche 908, and Subaru has even built a flat 12 to try their hand in building engines for F1. There's also a Ferrari flat 12 out there, but it's really not technically a flat 12. There's some like technicalities because they share crank pins. A true flat 12 would have separate crank pins, but it's there. Actually, in 1971, Porsche developed a flat 16 prototype for their 917 that raced in the Can-Am series, but instead they ditched it and went with a flat 12 that was turbocharged. Opposing piston engines often get confused with boxer engines, but they are different. While the flat layout is similar, opposing piston engines have pistons that meet in the middle. They don't have a cylinder head. And because of this, these engines have the potential to lower emissions compared to a more standard layout. Acadie's Power has been building diesel versions of these engines for some time now, but the opposing piston design have been around since the early 1900s. The Commer TS3 Commer Knocker was an opposing piston engine put in Commer trucks in the 50s and 60s. It uses two pistons per cylinder, three cylinders total, unlike an opposing cylinder engine like the Napier Delta. It used only one central crank, and it's voted the most unique engine on this list by me. And when I think of the Wankel or rotary engine, gotta think of Mazda, spinning Dorito. In a Wankel type engine, there are no piston rods and no valve train components. There's a single piston that revolves around a geared shaft. The inside of this engine is shaped so that the triangular piston turns, it goes through all four cycles that a standard internal combustion engine would go through. That's the suck, the squeeze, bang, and blow. If you want a rotary to make more power, you only have a few ways to do it. You can use forced induction, or you can add more rotors. We have single rotors like the 40A, the good old 13B, or even better, 13B REW, and the RX-7 FD sported two rotors. Mazda also used a three rotor in the Le Mans race car, the 757. The R26B used a four rotor, and some Wankel lovers out there even have built their own six rotor and even 12 rotor design. That is a lot of spinny Doritos. The U engine, also known as the Square 4. These engines are two separate straight engines placed side by side and coupled at a shared output shaft. Look at them from the front and they look like, guess what letter, guys? A U. The Ariel Square 4 motorcycle and the Suzuki RG500 use this U engine. The benefit is that it's able to share common parts with the straight engine, which it was based on. Also, if there's two crankshafts rotating in opposite directions, the gyroscopic effect of those rotating components cancel out, so you have a naturally very, very smooth engine. Now, the H engine also uses a similar concept, but they're stacked vertically. An H engine or H block is a configuration in which the cylinders are aligned so that when you view it from the front, guess what letter it looks like, guys? That's right, NH. So flat fours often look like drunken H's from above, but an H block looks like an actual H when staring straight down the pipe. So an H engine can be viewed as two flat engines, either one on top of each other or side by side. They have their own crank, but are geared together to power the transmission. The British Racing Motors H16 Formula One engine won the 1966 US Grand Prix in the Lotus 43. There's even a 1000cc H4 in the Brough Superior Golden Dream. You know what my golden dream is? To shoot an episode of Bumper to Bumper in a Las Vegas hotel room. We had to come out here and shoot some episodes, and so there's no downtime. It's a Saturday. We could be out hitting the slots. Instead, we're in a friggin' hotel room shooting an episode of B2B. I hope you guys enjoyed this. This was fun making. There's a lot of crazy engines out there. I know I skipped over some. There's some technicalities. So if you're yelling at me in the comments, I don't want to hear it. Put them down there anyways. I'd like to see what I missed if I did, but I don't know if I did. Follow us here on Donut on Instagram at Donut Media. Follow me at Jeremiah Burton. Till next week, bye for now.